Good afternoon. I'm Natalie Melton, Creative Director of the Crafts Council, and it gives me great pleasure to welcome you to Collect 2021, the International Art Fair for Contemporary Craft and Design. Launched in 2004 by the Crafts Council, Collect is the leading art fair for contemporary craft and has been instrumental in developing and growing the market for collecting. Maintaining the open-hearted nature of the fair, and at a time when we can't all come together in the fair's home at Somerset House in London, it gives me great pleasure to welcome you to the online version of Collect for 2021. This year we have 32 carefully selected international galleries representing almost 400 artists spanning some 35 nations. The exceptional works for sale at Collect can be viewed at the online art platform at artsy.net, and the link will be displayed at the end of the talk for you to visit and enjoy. And I would really encourage you to take your time to enjoy and browse the works of art that you can see. They really are quite exceptional this year. Today, I'm delighted to be chairing a discussion called Crafted, the New Normal. Almost a year since the start of the international art, almost a year since the international art circuit went into lockdown, we reflect on a seismic year for the market, consider how this has impacted on craft, and explore what next. What steps will be needed to help the sector recover, and what positive changes can we adapt for good? Joining me this afternoon, I've got four fantastic panellists bringing their expertise and insight on the market to bear on our discussions. First of all, I'd like to welcome Angel Monzon, Creative Director of Vessel Gallery. Angel is the CEO and Creative Director of Vessel Gallery in Notting Hill, London. Established in 1999, Vessel represents the best of contemporary art glass, ceramics, design, and decorative lighting. Vessel has a regularly changing exhibitions programme that showcases both established and up-and-coming artists, craft makers, and designers. The gallery also participates in international art fairs with a focus on applied art, whether they're real or virtual. Angel also consults with both independent artists and companies in the profile development and direction of their designs and brand, and has been invited to curate exhibitions, mentor artists, and lectures in universities and organisations. Joining Angel is Christopher Day, glass artist. Chris is a bi-heritage Jamaican UK artist who uses his craft to navigate what it means to be black in the UK and also white. His new work, deeply personal in exploration, are often self-portraits that explore what it means to be of bi-heritage in the UK by playing on stereotypes and aspects of generalisations. Constantly aware of the complexity of race, his solo show, Blown, Bound and Bold, deals with the complexities of internalised racism, as well as the difficulty of establishing an identity that isn't just stratified, but overlooked by linear definitions of race and heritage. Glass is the perfect medium for Day to create emotional weight in his works by developing physical tension with them and affords the artist unending surprises. Welcome, Chris, it's lovely to have you. Next, we have Denis Shafranik, who's the co-founder of Concentric. Denis is a partner and co-founder of Concentric, a London and Copenhagen-based activist venture capital firm. It partners with sector-defining founders across Europe, enabling new technologies to solve the problems that matter in traditional economy sectors. Denis has a keen personal and professional interest in craft, with active involvement in several craft and design-focused businesses via ERMAC, an artistic and investment partnership. Denis's growing craft collection was profiled in the January and February 2021 issue of Crafts magazine. He's got quite an exceptional collection. Finally, we welcome Anders Peterson, who's the founder of Art Tactic and Managing Director. Art Tactic is an art market research firm based in London. The company uses techniques similar to those used in the financial markets to analyse the art market and build up art market trends. Anders previously worked at JP Morgan, responsible for debt capital market and structured products for banks and corporates. He also worked as an independent research and evaluation consultant for arts and business in London between 2002 and 2007, and has been involved in a number of research and evaluation projects in the cultural sector. Anders regularly lectures on a variety of art market topics for Sotheby's Institute in London, Christie's Education, and ESA in Beirut. He's also a founding board member of Professional Advisors to the International Art Market. I'm really delighted to welcome Anders to bring his insight to bear on the conversation today. So, without further ado, I think, Anders, I'd really like to start by asking you if you can just perhaps highlight some of the really sort of key shifts and changes that have happened in the art market over the last 12 months, just to help us set the scene for the discussion.
Thanks, Natalie. Well, it's been some incredible period that we've gone through. I mean, I think it's, on one hand, we've had, obviously in March, well, exactly a year ago, the art world went into more or less a lockdown, which meant that all physical events, art fairs, auctions, gallery exhibitions, everything was closed or postponed. And I think the art world, you know, obviously was forced to find alternative channels. And, you know, the major thing that we've seen over the last 12 months is the incredible growth in online activity, online sales, but not only on the sales side, but just in generally that the entire world, I guess, has now spending most of their time online, whether it's in front of Zoom like today or looking up on social media, etc. And this, the figures this year was quite exceptional. We haven't yet finished looking at exactly what's happened for 2020, but already we're starting to see signals in the auction markets, where Sotheby's, Christie's and Phillips, just as an example, regarding their online only sales, just broke through the $1 billion mark this year, which is more than 500% higher than there was in 2019. And it's been a real sort of, I would say, systemic shift in the market as a whole. This is not sort of, obviously these growth rates will not continue, but I think what's happened is there's been a change in perception. There's been a change regarding the opportunities that that both the trade as well as consumers are finding with regards to engagement online. And I think, you know, one of the things that we've seen is that actually the pandemic has led to a real increase in confidence among buyers. This was one of the problems in the past, is that a lot of people felt that the online, you know, compared to the physical, particularly when you're dealing with physical objects, was a tough threshold to kind of go through to buy things without touching and seeing and so forth. I think this has kind of changed this year, and we've seen that, you know, more than 60% of the particularly new buyers and younger buyers are feeling increasingly confident in buying. In this case, it's mostly fine art, but I think, you know, they will see this thing across all the categories, also in crafts. And a lot of people have bought. I mean, we looked at existing buyers, and particularly again among younger generation, where 70% of millennials has bought art during the pandemic. So I think, you know, clearly the fact that I guess normal practices of buying art has kind of been has been impossible, which meant people has been forced online. But I think that has actually now lifted the market to another level where, like technology, very rarely we go backwards. You know, we change behavior, and I think we change behavior in many ways during this pandemic, which is likely to set a sort of a new phase for where the market is going forward. And I think that's partly, and that will also, I think, will largely shape the market going forward. So, I mean, I guess many of these things will come back in the discussion today, but I really, despite the difficulties that the market has had and everyone within it, I think, you know, this is the move to digital has kind of presented a new level of opportunities that I think, you know, we will benefit from, you know, decades to come. So I think we're just at the sort of very early stages of a kind of a mini digital transformation in the art world and the wider collectibles market that I think is actually quite exciting going forward. Not to say that we all, I think, are looking forward to go back to the physical world again as soon as we can, but in the meantime, these two worlds probably will coexist.
Thank you, Anders. That's such a brilliant kind of overview of some of the shifts in the market for us. And I'd really like to come to Angel and I think one of the challenges with craft has been that people have often said that because they are such tactile objects, it's very difficult to make that work and translate into a purely online world. Necessity has perhaps shifted that perception. But Angel, can you back that up with your experience over the last 12 months? Angel, I'm going to ask you to unmute your microphone.
There we go. I'm
unmuted. There we go. Straight in.
Gosh, now I heard your question. It's been an exceptional year and not an easy one. we're still here, and we actually have had we're having growth, which is very interesting. Come a year ago, I thought this was going to be over. This is it. But we have had great growth, and but with great difficulty as well. I think you need to be prepared for this new digital new world. You need to have your things in place, your media, your images, your copy, your information, very, very clearly indicated on your platforms. And the growth has been slowly and organic, because I don't think there is any shortcuts or low value. If you don't have a blank checkbook, you just have to do it slowly and organic, because to join some of these major platforms, they're very costly. And to get good quality traffic, you have to pay a lot. We, besides running our own operation digitally, we also part of other platforms like First Dips and similar, and they are costly operations, but they have quality visitors, which has helped us to grow.
And so, I think we spoke at Collect two years ago, I believe. And I think we talked a little bit about digital then, and obviously that had already been an area that you were sort of exploring and making use of. So you've probably had an advantage in as much as it was something that you were already comfortable with, and you've sort of been able to try and test what works and what doesn't, and be prepared for this.
We were prepared. I still feel like we're behind, because we're not even transactional in our website. But given the business model and what we do, I think it's fine to have that extra click of people having a little brief conversation with us about the object they're buying, like, is it still available? Is the information clear? Things like that, small things. And we need to sort out shipping and various other sort of housekeeping things to do with a sale of this nature. But we have certainly cranked up the volume and invested more and more in our website and on our presence online. Yes.
Yeah. So it's reassuring to hear that it hasn't been all bad for you over the last 12 months.
Well, there are challenges, like I said, and we are growing slowly and organic. And there are also challenges with the digitalization and the democracy of digitalization. In fact, that we have to compete with our artists now, because you have marketplaces that are welcoming both artists and galleries, and that kind of hybrid is very tricky, very difficult to navigate.
Yeah.
Which relies very much on the personal relationships the gallery have with artists. But it can turn sour a little bit as well.
Yeah, okay. I think that's something that we can probably loop back to a little bit further in the conversation, because I think it's a really interesting area to explore. I'd like to come to Denis now, if I can. And actually, before I sort of pose a question to you, for our audience, I'd just like to say, if you do want to ask questions, there's a Q&A facility. You're very welcome to pose questions in that. And at the end, we'll make sure that we leave some time to pick up on some of those questions. I'm afraid my digital housekeeping probably isn't what it should be, and I should have mentioned that at the beginning. Denis, your kind of professional expertise is really looking at how technologies can transform existing marketplaces. Is this sort of digital revolution in the art world long overdue?
I think to some extent, yes, Natalie. You know, it's historically a very physical sector, isn't it? And for the right reasons, perhaps. But digital has given a massive access to new consumers in other sectors, and now it's great to see that that's also starting to happen in the art and in the contemporary craft space. I think it can only be a positive for galleries, for artists, for those who need to access broader audiences and also to engage existing clients in a new way.
And have you taken advantage of some of those shifts yourself over the last year in terms of the ways in which you're perhaps acquiring works?
I guess we all had to, right? So we had to kind of shift online. I think it was a necessity. So it's difficult to answer that, right? Because if that wasn't the case, then would you have sort of bought digitally? Don't know. But yes, I mean, I have. I guess the downside is that probably bought from contacts I already had previously. There's probably a way to go, and that's maybe a positive. There's a way to go to engage new collectors through digital channel rather than just engage the existing collector contacts.
Yeah, it doesn't.
Certainly, I guess most people have transacted craft and art online, and we have certainly seen our group has seen that also work with other galleries and marketplaces we've sort of been observing.
Yeah. And I think, I mean, as you make a very good point that a lot of this is just about, it's really about an existing audience being able to continue to transact, and there might be a little bit of kind of bleed around the edges. But as Angel sort of pointed to, the cost of acquisition in a digital space, particularly when it is so popular right now, is actually pretty high. Angel, do you worry that it puts undue strain on businesses that still want to maintain a physical presence, particularly in a city like London, which is incredibly expensive? Are we expecting people to try and operate across too many platforms? Is there a risk there?
Simple questions is, I haven't got a clue what's going to happen. when Denis was talking, I was thinking these are two separate businesses. This is what everyone's been confronted with. In fact, I'm a bricks and mortar business, a gallery for 15 years, and suddenly we've turned into a business with the same turnover, but being purely digital and online. So yeah, I do ask myself, why do I have my bricks and mortar? I expect some of those people to switch off from the digital, come back to see me. I hope so. Or if not, I'm suddenly being handed two separate businesses, which could be quite interesting. No, there is, listen, I ask myself this every day, because the very different business require different requirements, different infrastructure. They're very different. But I can't wait to open up the doors and welcome people, and because I have cabin fever being here alone.
yeah, and I think you know, inevitably there is going to be a kind of rush of exhilaration as we all venture out, and you know, I for one am absolutely desperate to get out and see things for real. But obviously we're facing big question marks about how you sustain a business where suddenly you've had to invest across entirely new areas of the business, but there's still an expectation that you're maintaining your bricks and mortar premises as well. And I guess one of the interesting things is that in this shift to digital, this might be a question for Anders, are we simply replicating the existing structures of the market in a digital space, or is there room for innovation? So, you know, algorithms tend to favour the biggest and the most popular. Is there scope for kind of disruptors in the market to succeed? Is that something that you can answer, Anders? Is that something that you're looking at?
No, I think the problem is actually if you try to replicate the offline model in the online world, you have a problem. I think that it's a little bit like Angel said regarding is actually running two businesses, and they are very, very different. They're very different to how you actually deal with an online audience vis-a-vis an offline audience, and in almost all regard. And that's taking a tech business versus a normal retail business. It's fundamentally different. And I think this is maybe they've been the problem of what we've seen in the first, I would say the first phase of the sort of move from with the art world or the art market, and probably in the crafts world as well, you know, from towards an online, is that there's been an attempt to replicate the same way of doing business online as you do offline. And you know, simple things like transparency around pricing, for example. You know, online consumers are increasingly, you know, they're impatient and they want to have things straight up. If they don't, they just click away. Of course, you will have, you know, dedicated fans that will always submit an email to find more, you know, more information and are curious. But if you are talking about kind of capturing a broader audience, you know, this is the attention span of consumers are incredibly short. So I think, you know, at the moment we're in this quite tricky sort of in between stage where the art world has been forced in a very short space of time to kind of move online, because that's the only viable kind of route at the moment. Running a tech business is resource, you know, resource, it requires resources, it requires money, it requires, it's scale and size, which I think it presents an overall problem for many in the, you know, in the sort of arts and crafts world, because there are smaller passionate businesses run on different premises. It's not all about growth and profit margins, et cetera. And I think we're up in this sort of slightly, how do you maintain the integrity of what you're doing and transfer that into an online space? I do think there is, but besides that, I do think there's a lot of scope for being innovative, but maybe So one side is obviously the sales side. The other thing is the kind of experiences you can maybe recreate online, which you otherwise wouldn't be able, whether it's, you know, the, you know, increasing adaption of technologies like, you know, virtual reality, augmented reality, I think, you know, can work really well as new ways of, for people to engage with arts and crafts. So I think we're going to see now, I think we are sort of, we have kind of broken, as I said earlier, sort of kind of through a threshold about, you know, what online, is it important or not? And I think prior to COVID, I think, you know, there was a kind of, yeah, online is, you know, there's obviously a potential there, but there was no one was really forced to kind of really put their, you know, put their attention, you know, deeply into it. And I think now most people are, and I think this will kind of create opportunities. It's also been a radical change in the way that, around behavior regarding people also visiting and seeing and experiencing, they want something different. And I think we're still at the early stages, but I do feel that we kind of from going onwards, I think we're going to start to see a significant amount of innovation, maybe initially among the more resourceful entities within the art market, but that will hopefully also open up the gates for others to kind of follow. So but I think this thing of trying to replicate offline online, I think that's probably is a mistake. I think that just doesn't work. Those two worlds are different, which poses the question, what is that online world and that identity? What is that actually then going to be?
Who is there anybody in the art world that you think is doing it particularly well, who has really started to push the boundaries of what you can do on online in the art market?
I mean, I think the auction model, or the auction houses, particularly Sotheby's in this case, has been very at the forefront of innovating in that space. And it's been maybe a little bit easier for the auction model to kind of adapt to the crisis than it is for a gallery. I mean, auction has sort of an embedded sort of time limit. It's a pressure. You've got to make decisions quite quick. I think what's interesting about the model is just how, you know, these hybrid versions of, you know, using a different type of production value, the way you explain art, the way you show art, the way you could use, you know, the digital medium to explain what's going on in the auction. You could create an atmosphere, which is kind of introduces new competitive elements. So not only do you have the physical buyers in the room and on the telephone, you also now have online buyers, but it feels much more in a sense that it's an educational experience as well. There's more resources going into thinking about content and how you position the content. I mean, simply a flat catalog is not that's not going to work in this environment. So using, you know, a mixed medium of interviews and films, all those things, I think, has kind of, I guess, engaged a new type of audience that probably otherwise would think auctions are pretty boring. But I don't think that model necessarily can be applied to the gallery world, but I think everyone will need to kind of find their own, and I guess their own model for whatever they do, and which could involve, as I said, you know, new types of technology like virtual reality, augmented reality, and many other things. I mean, there's also the form of creating excitement around. I mean, I think there's things to be learned in the world of more kind of wider collectibles, like, you know, the way that sneakers are using drops, you know, to kind of create a sense of, and I guess a gallery or an artist can do the same thing, that on a certain date and a specific thing, a certain limited edition might be released. I mean, there's things that you can do that doesn't necessarily distort the process of, you know, enjoyment of the actual artwork, but creates a little bit more sort of sense of urgency and some sense of competition that I think could be quite fun also, you know, in the sort of gallery and even artists themselves.
Yeah. Angel, to come back to you, then you've sort of been testing a new model of collaboration, haven't you? And I wonder if you might want to just say a little bit about Crafting a Difference and what the kind of impetus was and how it's working.
Correct. That's Crafting a Difference was an initiative taken by five London-based galleries together with a curator in the middle of the lockdown, the pandemic. And the whole premise of the exhibition was to come together at the time with so many being forced apart, and to increase exposure and improve the viewing of physical works in a virtual world. So yeah, have a four or five slides. This is a building in Marylebone where a lovely gallerist who runs an atelier called Shiro Muchiri runs a gallery called Shoshiro, and she invited us to curate an exhibition for us five. There's four other galleries are Cavalier and Finn, Ting Ying, Made in Brittany, and Jagged Art. And we set up a 3 month long exhibition with two different hangs. We hanged an exhibition for the London Art Fair to coincide with the London Art Fair, and then a new exhibition to coincide with Collect. In essence, there's about 70 artists showcasing over 250 works of art over five floors. And the beauty of this exhibition that we have floors which are like gallery-esque, sort of more white cube style, and then other floors which are more domestic home style. So, and even like little curio rooms, like you can see here that Brian's done an excellent curation of black works. And the previous edition, we had all white works in a little curio room. And there's even a room with a kitchen and in which we'll showcase work as one would in their homes. And I think the next slide might be a slide of, if there's another one, I'm not sure. No, so the last one. Anyhow, so yes, you can, this room, for example, includes some of the owner of Shiro, who's also a furniture designer, has some of her own designs in which we have made a combination of our own artworks and her. Yeah. Furniture. Nevertheless, it's been a very interesting collaboration and possibly the way forward, I think. So smaller events, more niche boutique events, which has already been happening in the last decade in ski resorts and marinas and beach resorts. And I think that we're going to see more of that, because I think people will be scared of the big events with thousands of people cramming.
Well, I think what's interesting is it perhaps gives a bit more time. You know, you can stretch these out, can't you? So there's a longer time frame so that people can perhaps view at leisure. And I think whilst social distancing measures are still in place, then obviously I think we're all looking at how we can extend runs of things to ensure that you can still get the same number of people coming through, albeit in a much more considered way. I think what's been really fascinating, observing, you know, how people have responded to Collect in a digital world, is that desire to still create quite haptic experiences for audiences by locating work in gallery spaces, by collaborating, bringing groupings of work together, and obviously using your own digital reach amplified across a number of different galleries to drive an audience in. And I think it raises some interesting questions about then what the role of the fair looks like going forward as a sort of audience development function, as well as an opportunity to see works for real. I think it would be appropriate and lovely at this point to actually look in more detail at some of Chris's work. And Chris, if I can bring you into the conversation, I was lucky enough to see your solo show at Vessel last year in one of those brief moments where we could kind of dash out and go and look at things for real. And, you know, it was a really moving and powerful show. And obviously, you know, the work, I had a very kind of visceral response to it, but it dealt with topics that have become very, very pertinent, sadly, over the last 12 months in terms of looking at issues of racism, colonialism. And I just wonder whether you could say a few words about the works for us and just talk us through some of the pieces that you're showing at Collect.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, if we look at the first image, Strange Fruit. So this is where I actually met Angel, and this was at the Glass Biennale in 2019. And if it wasn't for Angel, I wouldn't be sat here talking to you today, I don't think, because although I was producing work like this, that, like you say, is dealing with issues of racism, and this one's talking about lynching in America during the Jim Crow era. And the lynchings were to try and keep black people submissive. You know, the slave trade had just finished and they were scared. So lynching was a way of keeping people in their place and scared to actually revolt or to do any harm. And so when you're producing work like this, and for me being a student at Wolverhampton University, is that I didn't feel as if I was, let's say, old enough or good enough to actually be in showing work like this in big galleries. You know, I was still a student. So to actually be accepted in the Biennale was like, I was blown away, you know, and especially about what the work's about. But then for actual Angel to come up to me and discuss about the work, at the time, I didn't even know who Angel was. I didn't know what Vessel Gallery was. You know, I was that immersed in the university that the outside world was barren to me, you know. So when I did find out who Angel was, I was scared to death, to be honest. You know, you've got a guy that's got stuff in a gallery that's got the glass artists that are exquisite. You know, Kathleen Shillings and Elliot Walker are people that I've looked up to. And when I look at their work, it's just beautiful. Whereas my work, as Angel calls it, beautiful, ugly, is it's talking about things that have happened in the past that are horrific, but it's this discussion that we need, you know, and I'm hoping that these kinds of works will actually start that discussion and involve people not to be scared. You know, the work is beautiful in some respects. And I think that's like the spider's web. It entices the fly in, but it's got a horrific ending. And that's what I'm trying to do, is just talk. And that's what we all need, you know, from what happened during the summer to George Floyd, is that the response has started people to engage with this conversation about aspects of history and about racism. And it's a discussion that needs to be had. And I think the art, and especially I've found out recently, you know, I've only been doing this, well, since the exhibition down with Angel, you know, it's been a rocket ship ride. So in 8 months from doing the exhibition to having a piece of work acquired by the V&A, I can't take it all in. But all this is down to one person exposing my work onto a bigger platform. And so we need people like Angel, we need gallery owners to go out there and visit the universities, visit the small people that are out there that, like me, I wouldn't, if it wasn't for Angel, I wouldn't be sat here talking to you, because nobody else was interested in my work. Although the work is interesting now, there was nobody approaching me. You know, I hoped when I went to the British Biennale that I would meet somebody like Angel, and I did. But there was nobody else. There wasn't a line of people saying, oh, Will, we want to interview you on this subject. We want to do this. We want you to do a talk. There was just Angel. And so when we had the exhibition down London, the blown, bound and bold, I thought the bold was representing my hairstyle. But I laughed to him. But it was a bold decision on him to actually put me in an exhibition down London about racism. George Floyd had just happened. So I said to him, you know, we're putting our heads above the parapet. And I feel extremely proud that he took me on and showed me to the world, because otherwise, like I say, I wouldn't be here and I wouldn't be going into the V&A. But the good thing about the V&A is that discussion can still be had now. You know, Emmett Till will bring that discussion to the V&A.
I think, thanks, Chris. I mean, congratulations on the acquisition by the V&A as well. Oh, I'm really delighted to see that. And that's a piece that they've selected from Collect this year, isn't it?
It is, yes.
I think one of the great things that we've seen over the last few months is this sort of transparency about the relationship between the artist and the gallery. And I think the galleries have done a very effective job of really not just showing the work, but really helping audiences understand the process and the individuals behind the work, where we've all turned to social media and obviously we're all looking for kind of interesting narrative and content. For me, that's one of the things that has been really really effective, and I think your sort of eloquence in talking about the relationship with Angel and the gallery really is testament to that. Just picking up on what you just said about the acquisition by the V&A. I know in an interview that you did a little while ago, you said that you thought you were the only black glass artist in the UK. Mm. Surely that must change now.
Oh, it's definitely changed. It changed after I did the BBC interview, to be honest. You know, people started to say, you know, there's a black guy down here doing glass blowing, or there's somebody here. But even still, I've only got three names extra, you know, so there's still an issue of, you know, why aren't ethnic people being involved with glass, you know? And even for myself, the biggest problem is how much it is, you know. It's an art form that turns itself elitist because you've got to have the money to be able to do it. You know, I'm quite fortunate that I've got my own business and I can support myself to do that. But even still, if I didn't have people interested in my work, would I be able to go into a studio for a day and just have a play, which most of my work is? It's just me enjoying the process of producing work. It's not a matter of producing like on a production line where I'm having to reel it out as a daily living. I'm doing it because it is from the heart. It's stuff that I'm responding to and to get them emotions out from myself. And I think the problem is it is expensive, and we haven't got a cooperative in the UK that can allow people to do it freely. There is one up in Scotland, Northlands Creative, which help a lot and do a lot of residencies for people, but it's way out north, you know. It's proper out in the sticks. There's nothing Midlands based, and there's the glass hub down south somewhere, but that is it. But you're still doing a residency, you're still having to try and, these people that want to do glass know about it. It's the ones that don't know about it that you want to try and involve with, you know, the schools, the kids on the council estates, you know, they perhaps don't even know what a glass blower is, you know. So it's that kind of involvement I want to try and get involved with, is to introduce glass to people that don't know anything about it.
And of course, that's at a point where we know that one of the things that's really, really suffered during the pandemic is our children's education.
Definitely.
The catch up will be inevitably focused on the sort of core subjects. And it's a real concern for us that creative education is being sidelined in schools. And yet, one, you know, our kind of creativity as a nation is one of the strengths for us economically, culturally, but also, as you say, it will be impossible to change some of those kind of structural imbalances in some of these kind of craft professions unless we take a really hard look at what the kind of progression routes are, right from the bottom all the way up. And I don't know, you know, there's a fairly fundamental conversation that needs to be had across all elements of the sector to really start to shift that. I think coming back to the kind of insights that you shared with us at the beginning, Anders, one of the things that has changed, I think, is that motivations for buying, we've seen an interesting shift where people are buying not just because it's, you know, having art and craft makes them feel good in their own homes, but also I think particularly amongst the younger generation, this idea of supporting artists, investing in them to support their kind of creative pursuits seems to have become more important. Have I got that right?
Yeah, no, definitely. I mean, we looked at this last year just in terms of why people, you know, what's the primary motivation for buying art beyond, I guess, the passion and emotional sort of personal values. It was this sense of, you know, social purpose and of helping and supporting artists. And I think it comes a little bit back to Chris's regarding, you know, how do you support artists in their early stages? And I think, And I'm sure Denis might have also ideas around this. I mean, I think, you know, thinking about an infrastructure that might not be public, in a sense, it's not necessarily public money, but it could be private. I mean, in the world that I know Denis probably is evolving, you know, whether it's incubators or where you support artists, you know, from the beginning, leaving school, the kind of advice that Angel probably has already given to Chris regarding, you know, career advice, but also offering studio space. I think there are opportunities for, even on many levels, you don't necessarily need to be a patron with millions of, it could be also done through, I think, an interesting things are happening now, obviously in the crowdfunding space, where you have Patreon, for example, in the US, which maybe is more tilted towards sort of podcasters and things like that. But I think, you know, similar models can be applied in the art world, where you will have a fan base, which might be linked to your social media following. So instead of just purely following and liking your works, maybe could they give a fiver a month to support your practice, and in return they might have an insight into your studio. That doesn't necessarily, I mean, the exchange doesn't necessarily need to be monetary or financial. It could be feeling of being a membership. You go to the gym, you feel well after being at the gym. If you're a membership of Chris's fan club, you know, could we, by giving a fiver, we might get an insight into his, the way he makes the work, maybe a private, I mean, I think there are ways we can be a bit, and I think this is maybe thinking about innovation and your question regarding innovation. I think there are opportunities of thinking about how we can get more people involved, and that would ultimately, I think, will create more potential new collectors, but it will also help the creators, which I think, you know, probably, and many has suffered, you know, during this period. Obviously, we might be lucky being in the Western world, moved to other parts of the world where there is no public funding and support for creatives. I mean, how do we, you know, how do we support that next generation? And I think there is I feel that already there's this change among audiences that there is a sort of a goodwill, or there's a sort of a sense of finding purpose in everything you do. And I think we've come to that point where if we can create vehicles that allows people to engage with artists and artworks in a slightly different way from purely outside consumption, I think there is opportunities there for all parties. I think consumers want to be closer to the artists. I'm not sure if the artists want to be closer to the consumer, but I think it's at least there are opportunities to to do something there, which is, I think, it's to be quite exciting.
Yeah, Denis, do you have any thoughts on that?
No, I think Anne's absolutely right. You know, what can I say? It's great that this trend is happening. I mean, I wasn't aware that this motivation is so high on the agenda for buyers, which is incredible to hear. I mean, for certain, when I started buying craft, one of the strong motivations was to get to understand the artist, to be able to kind of engage with them, obviously physically in that sort of day and age. But perhaps now, you know, the online channel can be used to help further that substantially, like it has helped for a lot of other creative sectors or fashion economy sectors, as they're called these days. And I think in that context, what you mentioned, Natalie, I think regarding fairs and galleries, I think their role will actually increase to a large degree in facilitating this interchange. Perhaps not in a sort of once a year, you know, let's bring it all together, big bang kind of event, where a lot of artists get left out, of course, but perhaps through a more sort of holistic side ventures that are co-branded by the galleries and the fairs that have a big pool in the public eye to support artists ultimately, or to provide a channel for individuals who are not perhaps even collectors, but who are keen to support the ecosystem, to kind of voice that support, whether financially or whether through social media or some other way yet to be sort of discovered. I think that's probably a trend that I see happening sort of over the next couple of years.
Yeah.
But equally, probably fair to say that some of the artists who are better equipped in dealing with the society at large through social media, I think are now able to strike on their own and create communities of their own, and perhaps cut out the existing art infrastructure. I certainly see that with a couple of perhaps much higher sort of profile and much better established sort of craftspeople, a very small number, but nevertheless, I think that's also to keep in mind.
Yeah, I guess the sort of chains that bind artists and galleries in the craft world aren't necessarily as kind of rigid as they perhaps are in the art world, where those relationships tend to be locked down in a much stronger way. Angel, that's something that you referred to earlier on, sort of, the challenge of disintermediation, where artists can potentially bypass the gallery. Is that a real threat to you?
Well, it's always been there. It's always existed. It's always been the artists that solo promote themselves, gone solo, and at least for the last 5 to 8 years. The problem is that many of them, we had a few people come around after a decade, and they realize they haven't been bought by any particular important collectors. They haven't ended up in any museums or collections. That's the downside. It's considerably more difficult to do that on your own. Yeah. Of course, it has been amplified now. I mean, we have one very successful artist who's, for example, has grown from a social media audience of a couple of thousand to 60, 70,000. And he can do almost like the dropship model that Anders talked about. He can create editions and once a month be selling out those editions. What's our role? But I think... Listen, this had been coming for a long time, at least 5 years, 5, 7 years. We made a conscious decision in the gallery, like we will only play the game with the ones which are transparent and want to play with us. Otherwise, the ones that want to do solo, please go ahead. But we have a very good relationship. We've got something else to offer. We're not just like a normal gallery. We take on emerging artists like Chris and we help to build them up. We give them a platform. And before we even... after our first meeting, I knew you're going to invest X amount on Chris, and it goes in the several thousands of which we invest in the artist, but given space, investing time, printing a catalogue, the list is endless. And I do with all my heart, and because we're in it together, and we want to both grow. I want the artist to grow, I want the gallery to grow. So you just have to find those sort of talents that are willing to grow with you. But yes, yeah. Some of them have gone solo. They're happy to do it themselves because it's also the market. The markets are backstabbing you sometimes. You do have people that they know that I have the work. It is my work in essence. Sometimes it is our work because we co-edit some of the work, but they will try to circumnavigate you and they're trying to go direct to the artist and eventually comes back to us. But I would say at least a third of the very savvy buyers are trying it on to bypass the gallery and the dealer.
Yeah.
But you have to set up your, you have to prepare your strategy.
Yeah, and focus on what your areas of expertise are. So inevitably things like commissions, very often the complexity of large scale commissions is something that can be quite challenging for artists to undertake on their own, where you've built up years of experience of being able to do that.
Well, correct. We half of our business is B2B, so we work a lot with consultants, architects, interior designers, and we do very complex works. Like we our artists produce works for yachting or like planes, and you have to know what you're doing. You have to know how to secure these works, and you have to make specialist spaces for them, and that artists don't want to handle that. They just want to sell a piece and wash their hands.
I'm conscious that there's a fair few questions coming in, and I think what I'd like to do is pick up on some of the questions, and then just to conclude I'd like to loop back and just ask each of you whether there's one particular sort of shift that's happened over the last 12 months that you think would you'd like to kind of see continue into the future that gives you cause for optimism, perhaps in terms of the market. Isabel, are you there to perhaps
throw a few
questions at the...
Yeah, sorry, I've been madly fielding stuff here in the background. I think there's a lot of love for Angel here. And so they're very completely hoping there's more angels around. It's a very appropriate name. Got a great name there. This is actually more one for Chris, which I think is really interesting. It's from Grace. It says, does Chris find it hard sometimes to make his work, considering how tragic and disturbing history and the stories of the people like Emmett Till are? How does he do that, and how do you deal with that?
I don't deal with it very well, to be honest. When I was looking at Emmett Till, I was looking at so many images over a weekend that I had to do a discussion with my lecturer the next day. And instead of being able to talk to him, I just burst out crying. But I think, I wouldn't say I get immune to it, but over this last course, I found because I have to do discussions like this and talk about the work, that I have to build that strength to be able to talk about it. But when I'm looking at images, it's going to affect you. And the only way I can get that out is by producing the work. So when I produce these pieces of work, I'm hoping that they'll have that effect of causing that discussion and somebody else can talk about it and not reflect in books. You know, I'm having to look at these images in books or on the internet, which is a brilliant way of seeing them. But other than the internet, these things were lost on bookshelves. So now that I can get the artwork out there to start discussing it, and then when they see names like George Stinney, who perhaps some people don't know about, then they can start to research for themselves about the historic and brutal way that he was killed, then, you know, they can start to see. But no, it's not an easy ride, to be honest, but it's a thing that I've got to do and I'm going to try to continue doing.
Fantastic, thank you. This is from Hannah, and this is kind of going back to actually what quite a few of you have been saying, but I think it's just understanding a little bit more about what will help in an online world to help that process of a collector to have that greater confidence in purchasing, particularly when it's with a new artist. And you've mentioned that it's actually good to possibly get to know the artists themselves a bit better via gallery. But what would you say in your kind of experience of this last year, what is going to be the most impactful to encourage a collector? And I suppose I'm pointing this at probably Denis and Anders and Angel, to be honest. So I'm not sure who wants to answer that, but it's just, what do we think is going to really help that engagement to help people feel confident to purchase online?
Happy to kick off.
Go on then.
I think the online in the craft world is still a ground zero, to be frank, right? We're sort of using existing tools set up perhaps for a different purpose to sell a different type of product or service. And we're adopting it for the haptic, you know, very kind of haptic objects. And I'm not sure that's sort of where it's going to end. But hopefully there'll be more innovation around how this channel can be much more immersive for the collector, you know, from a different continent, discovering a new artist altogether. So that's probably a first sort of disclaimer. And also, I think there is a longing to get back to physical, actually, connection with the objects at the end of the day. I think physical exhibitions will continue to be important, and perhaps around the model, a distributed model like Angel mentioned earlier, I think is an interesting development. Has always been there, but I guess now it's just proven that it works quite effectively. And also, you know, we can also look at other verticals like fashion, where the engagement in over the last year has been much more hybrid with buyers, where they receive something perhaps over the post or in a physical gallery setting that they can engage with, and then that supplements the much more digital, a much more immersive experience than we currently have in craft. That's probably how kind of I see it developing, hopefully.
Okay. I agree with Denis. I think the experience side, the storytelling aspect of you know, getting involved in the artist, understanding the, you know, both from the production and how, but also kind of obviously the meaning and relevance and all these things. I think it's, I think the online has an amazing opportunity to storytell and in all kinds of different mediums. I think that thing is one aspect. I think the one of the challenges is where we see more on a practical level is the sort of level of is trust. How do you build trust in the online? And unfortunately, at the moment, I think, you know, the art world is facing a lot of frictions when it comes to that aspect of trust. That's from, you know, if you're new to this world, when you enter onto a platform, how can you trust a platform? What are the signals that these platforms are sending that I am a trustful platform? And I think, you know, in the crafts and art world in general, there's a lot of incredibly you know, credible and reputable players, but often only known to that world itself, not really communicated outside to other people. So I think these things would creating trust all the way from, you know, the fulfillment, which Angel mentioned, you know, how do you deal with logistics? I mean, this, I think, is a problem now in this world where we're living with Amazon Prime. People are expecting everything to happen within a very short space of time. And I think it's how do we manage these expectations in a world that is not an Amazon world, and probably hopefully will actually never be an Amazon world. But at the same time, we need to kind of meet the expectations that consumer has when they are, for example, Denis mentioned fashion. You know, when you do things, you kind of, well, there's a certain brand, which obviously recognition and value and trust in the brand that drives the traffic in the art world. How do we recreate all our own kind of rule book for how to creating trust in consumers? So I think, you know, there are technologies and the interesting, you know, things happening in the art world regarding now trying to address many of these things. You know, how do you, I mean, anything from kind of authenticity to down to condition, and how do we explain people that the, you know, in the absence of the physical object, how do we explain the, you know, the details of this object in the best possible way. So I think there is some time to go. As Denis said, I think we're not only the craft world, I think, you know, in many ways also maybe the art world in some way a little bit ahead, but not that much. And I think everyone is starting from ground, a little bit from ground zero now, to try to create a kind of a new experience for the collector or for the art enthusiast. There will be challenges ahead, but I think, you know, it will happen. So that's my.
Go on.
Thank you. Angel, I'm going to start with you. If there's one thing that you could kind of carry into the future that you've learned or that you've benefited from over the last 12 months, what would that be?
I hope I have continuous business success. That's what I want. No, Anders mentioned the word trust, and that's the key word. And I have to say, every day I ask myself, but we are engaging with people. People are engaging with us that I'm not aware of. I don't know who my clients are anymore. And that actually makes me a little bit nervous sometimes when I come in. You have a couple of requests, you have a couple of sales coming in every week, and we're very strong in the US currently, US, Middle East, Russia, Switzerland. I mean, we export a lot. I don't know who these individuals are. It saddens me a little bit, because prior to that, we've been around for 20 years, but very focused on gallery the last 10, 12 years. We knew what our clients, they would come in through the door. My US customers, they would come to London in the summer. We even have lunch with them sometimes. And now you just get these orders from customers in bizarre postcodes in New Orleans and Florida and Washington. I mean, you might even look up their houses, clearly very big houses, but you do wonder, who are these people? So clearly they must trust us somehow, whether they come direct through us or through one of the marketplaces that we work with. But I just like to know, we need to start engaging more with this digital online characters that we sell to.
Yeah, the trust and the opportunity to build relationships.
Yes.
Chris, what's for you? What's a note of optimism for you to look for, to think about?
I just don't.
Brexit.
Oh, sorry.
Go on, Chris.
No, go on, Denis.
Denis, Brexit is not a note of optimism. We'll come to that in a minute, very briefly.
Okay. I mean, for me, obviously, with what's happened with Emmett Till is just that this dialogue. About the racial injustice that's happened will carry on. You know, that's the most scary thing for me, was that I don't want to be like the thing that's being exposed at the moment, and then in a couple of months' time, it doesn't get that exposure which it needs. You know, George Floyd, I don't want it to be a flash in the pan. Yeah. I want this dialogue to keep going. That's my main thing, you know, just
lasting change.
Yeah, a lasting change, not just a brief moment. You know, there's been loads of George Floyds, loads of Emmett Tills, loads of George Stinneys. You know, we don't need any more. That's it. You know, let's hopefully this, you know, this dialogue will bring a change.
Yeah, agreed. Denis, you said Brexit. I was going to say we haven't had an opportunity to really talk about it, but when we picked up on the logistics issue earlier and fulfillment, Brexit's created enormous problems for the craft sector in terms of people being able to get things out into market. I think it warrants an entire panel discussion of its own. It's such a challenge.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't mean to talk about it, to be honest, Natalie, but I wanted to just kind of probably build on what Chris just said. You know, any crisis, and there's been a whole number of them over the last sort of 24 months, both around the work that Chris is doing and obviously the pandemic. I think there is a silver lining under each of them because it creates an impetus for creative output at the end of the day. You know, it's big societal changes that artists pick up on, and they create amazing new work and probably open new frontiers. I think that is the definite positive over the next however many years, but over the next sort of period, creative period. Yeah, I didn't mean Natalie to talk about Brexit. That's I'm not sure there's much positivity in the crafts community regarding that.
Neither, or much that we can say in 30 seconds, unfortunately. Yeah. Anders, I think the trust point was really, really valuable. Have you got anything else you want to add to that in about 3 seconds?
No, I think the most exciting thing is just new people coming to the market for the first time. I think we are at the cusp of hopefully broadening the interest in art, crafts, collectibles in general. And I think the online has been a major contributor to that. So I hope that will continue.
Brilliant. Thank you. I'm very conscious that we've run over time, but I just want to say a huge thank you to the panelists. You've brought such a kind of rich and diverse set of insight and opinion, both from within the craft sector and absolutely beyond. And I think it's so important to reflect on what's happening in other spaces to kind of bring that to bear on the craft world. Thank you to the audience. We've tried to answer as many of your questions as we possibly could throughout the conversation. But thank you for sticking with us, and do tune in to the rest of the talks if you can over the next 2 days. So thank you very much to all of you. Thank you.